Luke chapter 9 and verse 57, the Bible says, and it came to pass that, as they went in the way, a certain man said unto him, Lord, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest. And Jesus said unto him, foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. And he said to another, follow me. But he said, Lord, suffer me first to go bury my father. And Jesus saith unto him, let the dead bury their dead, but go thou and preach the kingdom of God. Another said, Lord, I will follow thee, but let me first go bid them farewell, which are at home at my house. And Jesus said unto him, no man having put his hand to the plough and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Amen. I'd like to preach, the Lord be my helper this morning, on the thought, are you sure you want to follow Jesus? Yeah. Dear Lord, we thank you for your kindness. We thank you for your goodness. Lord, we thank you from time to time for your leadership and guidance in the way. We praise you for that. Lord, we pray this morning for your help and your guidance. Lord, we always stand very needy of that. We pray this morning that you would guide. Lord, we pray that the Holy Spirit might come this way and that you might mingle about your word in the hearts of these people this morning. Lord God, we stand in need of a touch from you. We stand in need of knowing our own spiritual condition. We pray that you'd speak to the lost. Lord, we pray that you would draw the saved unto yourself, and that we would have a real desire to be closer to you. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, fairly familiar verses of Scripture. I think sometimes it may be pulled out of text. But I want you to see that it is really kind of toward... it's after, in Matthew's Gospel, it's after the Sermon on the Mount. It's very close to that in the chronological events of the Lord's ministry. Now, it deals with people who say they want to follow Jesus. It deals with people that have a zeal seemingly to go where the Lord would have, where the Lord has been and where the Lord would have you to go. Now, it's very easy to say, I want to follow Jesus. It is very easy to say, I want to do with my life what the Lord would have. And it all goes well until the Lord wants something that you don't. And then the difficulty begins because, listen, this flesh is depraved and what it wants is not usually good. What it desires is not usually well. And so very, very frequently when you really say, hey, I'm going to give myself unto the Lord, it's not what you planned. It's not what you thought maybe that it would be. And I believe that the Lord speaks of this. In verse 57, and it came to pass that as they went in the way. Now, I want you to see, that seems some just very minute words. But when it says that they went in the way, that by this point of his ministry, they've been following Jesus some 1.5 to 2 years. And they had continued in the way. They were going right in behind Jesus. They were doing what the Lord had asked them to do. They had seen some great things occur. They had seen some difficult times. And as they're going along that way, an event happens. Some things begin to change. Now listen, first of all, as you follow Jesus, there are going to be events come along your way. Now we like it smooth and we like it even and we like it, you know what? Sometimes there's bumps in the road. Sometimes there's difficulty along the way, and that's just part of it. And it came to pass as they went in the way, a certain man said unto him, Lord, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest. Now, what a wonderful commitment that he had to Christ. What a wonderful thing to say. But did he mean it? Wherever Christ went, that will go. That's where I want to be. A very mobile person. You know, the Lord Jesus Christ never even had a place to live. Does that sound like something you want to participate in? The house Don and I live in right now, I've lived longer there than anywhere in my whole life. We moved there in Memorial Day weekend was 20 years ago. I've never lived anywhere that long in my life. And you know what? It would be a whole lot just to pull up roots and say, hey, we're going to go somewhere else. My mother and father-in-law have been in their house 48 years. You know what? I doubt moving is on top of the list of things to do for 2017. We like to put down roots. But you know what? Our Lord Jesus was a very mobile individual. He was on the move doing what God bid him to do. So when this young man said that, we trust that he meant it. And when you say it, I hope that you mean it too. But when you follow Jesus, it usually is not stationary. By that I mean you're usually not there for very long. And the Lord let him know that. Notice what he says in verse 58. And Jesus said unto him, the foxes have holes, the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. Now, every one of us, when we finish here this evening, we will go to our homes and we'll either kick back in the recliner or we'll have an event that we want to do there at the house. Could you imagine, as night comes, not really knowing where you're going to be? Not really knowing where, you know what? We have a bed. Me and Donna have gone through lots of beds in 30 years of marriage. And we still haven't found the right one yet. And but could you imagine not ever having one? Literally not knowing where you're going to lay your head tonight. Literally maybe out in the dew, out in the wet. That's the life that Christ was calling his believers to. That was the life. Say, when he says, I'll follow you whithersoever. He says, do you mean that? Let me tell you what it's going to be like. Let me tell you the difficulty that arrives in the ministry. It's not health and wealth. It's not easy things to do. And so when you say, yes, I want to follow Christ, remember this and look on what you're saying. Verse 59. And he said unto another, this time Christ says it, follow me. But he says, Lord, suffer me first to go bury my father. Now, in verse 59, we get to a list of priorities that are very close to home, and that is our parents. You know, the Bible says, honor thy father and thy mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with thee and that thy days may be long upon the earth. Now, here he says, I need to go bury my father's body and then I'm with you. Well, you know what? Everything you do for your father is done when they're dead. You know, people don't like to think about that because it kind of, you know, sometimes you just have to let those kind of things go. What are you going to put first in your ministry? And you say, oh, well, that don't bother me because I'm not a preacher. Well, you may not be a preacher, but you do have a ministry. And the Lord will put you in situations that will cause you to question. When Judy was so sick, and I had a mission trip done scheduled, and I fully planned to go, do you think everybody would have patted me on the back if Judy had died when I was in Russia? I think I would have been actually highly, and God had planned that, Lord had planned that, but you know what? I've often thought if I did go, you know, I don't think it had been pats on the back, do you? I really don't. But that's part of it, that, you know, that's all you can do when they're dead. What's the accolades in a funeral? And so, as he said this, even though he was honoring his father, he says, listen, that's not where it's to be. Where are your priorities? What are you putting first? Verse 60. And Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their dead, but go thou and preach the kingdom of God. And another said, Lord, I will follow thee, but let me first bid them farewell, which are at home at my house. And he said unto them, no man having put his hand to the plough and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Now, I really want you to get verse 61 really carefully, because sometimes you have to just get up and go and do what the Lord's giving you to do, but we have tendency to do like this. Now, I don't want to get real specific, but many of us have gone to a different assembly, and if we'll be honest, if you ain't careful, you look back. Right? know, we just need to continue forward. If you're here by divine providence, you don't need to worry about anywhere else, do you? Don't look back. And you know what happened when you plow, and if you do look back, your roll's gonna be off. And it's not gonna be straight, it's not gonna be narrow, you're not gonna be online. So if we intend to follow the kingdom of God, quit looking back at what the world has to offer, what's in the world, what's of the world, just continue on. Because if God is sovereign, and certainly He is, you're here in this place at this time by divine appointment. So don't look back. And so we see then that they were, the Lord Jesus was very specific when it come to following Him, when it come to going forward in the things of the Lord. Now go back in the Gospel of Luke as well, this time chapter 2. Luke chapter 2 and verse 7, following Jesus. Luke chapter 2, verse 7, the Bible says, "And she," meaning Mary, "and she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn." Now, you know, the Catholic people have put such a wonderful, aura about the birth scene of the Lord Jesus Christ, and, you know, all these little things going around it. You know what? A barn is a barn. And it wasn't to be herald. If you want to know what a barn looks like, a pretty rough barn, you come and look at mine. And ladies, I would guarantee you none of you want your child's life to start out in the barn on top of my hill. And you know what? That's following Christ. When you say, you know, that's where He got His beginning. You know, there's nothing novel about that. It's nothing wonderful. It was starting in the lowest of the low of the low. That's following Jesus. Do you sure you want to follow Him? Boy, I do, but you need to know what you're getting into. You need to know what you're in for. I certainly do, but listen, when you wipe all the mischief of the Catholic Church off the birth scene, there's no grandeur in having a child be born in a barn. Verse 8, "And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring thee good tidings of great joy, which shall be unto all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." Now, that's the beginning of Christ. Very, very low, very humble way to begin. Now, do you want to follow Him? You know, seemingly in the modern day, they almost make it look good, like it's quaint. It's like a favorable. That's just one of the many heresies of Christmas. But you know what? It's nothing quaint and nothing pleasant about a child being born down at the barn. Do you ever think about that? When you get all the fluff off, that's not what I want for my children, my grandchildren, is it you? But that's how it started. So do you want to follow Christ? Do you want the humility that comes with your child being born in a barn? Because that is following Christ. If you want the Christ-like example, if you want to experience the things that Christ then experienced, this is the humility is there. Now go with me to the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3. And we'll begin reading in verse 13. Matthew chapter 3 and verse 13. The Bible says, "Then cometh Jesus unto Galilee, to Jordan, unto John, to be baptized of him." Now, before we jump too far into that, I just want to say this, that John was baptizing long before Christ, at least 2 to 3 years, and Christ was baptized. Now, There's many out there will say the baptism of John. And it was, in that sense, it was different. But Christ did not need redemption. Christ did not need salvation. And so, if those things are attached to baptism, then why did Christ get it? Why did Christ submit him to something he didn't need, if he didn't need it? There's no redemption in baptism. There's no salvation in baptism. And because Christ didn't need it. So we find John down at Jordan, very rough man, a very grisly man, down there baptizing, telling people to repent for the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is at hand. Then cometh Jesus unto Galilee, to Jordan, unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? Now, when he says, I need to be baptized of thee, he's saying, I need to be immersed of thee. I need to be put under. Now, when he said that, you know what? John wasn't necessarily talking about water baptism. He wanted to be immersed in the person of Christ. I need to be baptized with you, and you want me to baptize you? He didn't get it. You know, it had to be a very humbling thing to come to him and request baptism. It had to be something that the Lord Jesus Christ, number one, thought very importantly of, and number two, that it was a submission to what the Lord had given. Now notice what he says. And Jesus answered and said unto him, suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he suffered him. So I want you to see, he says, listen, it must be done to fulfill righteousness. He was validating everything that John the Baptist had ever done. He says, you go ahead and do it. You know what? That's pretty humbling, isn't it? Now, what most people didn't realize, I think John did, he was holding the very sinless Son of God in his hands to baptize. I think probably John got it better than most of those around him did. You know what? It was quite a submission for him to do that, wasn't it? Saying, you know, I'm submitting myself because the Father said so. I'm submitting myself to say, yes, John had a ministry, and it was done right. And so we see that as we begin to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, are you willing to do it in this way without any reservation, without any question? Verse 16, and Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened, and said unto him, were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him, and lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Now, I want you to see that that the Lord Jesus was willing to be subject. The Lord Jesus was willing to make a very broad, open, visual statement of where he stood. He was following the Father. He was following the Lord God of heaven. He was following in that. Now, today we live in a day and age where many don't even see need for following the Lord Jesus in that. You know, I've heard of people supposedly saved for many, many years and not interested in believers' baptism. I don't understand that. So we see that the Lord Jesus followed very carefully what the Lord had to do. Go with me to the Gospel of John this time, in the Gospel of John chapter 6. John 6, and we're going to begin reading in verse 60. John 6, beginning in verse 60, the Bible says, and Jesus knew, and when Jesus knew, he himself, When Jesus knew in himself that his disciples murmured at it, he said, "Doeth this offend you?" Now, what he had said was he was concerning taking and eating the meat of the Lord Jesus Christ and drinking the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Today, the Catholics still teach that this is transubstantiation, excuse me, that literally the blood and body of the Lord Jesus Christ is the Lord's Supper. But he was giving them a type. But he says, listen, if it offends you to eat of me, then you have no part of the kingdom. In other words, you know, they were willing to go so far. And when it got to the grisly parts, such as laying down your life for the name of Jesus, oh, we don't want to hear that. When it gets down to the point that you get thrown in prison, I that's not for me. I don't want to hear that. So he says, so this little thing of teaching you about the Lord's table in very figurative terms, that offends you? That upsets you? Thinking about drinking blood? Oh, does that gross you out? Well, let me tell you about pouring out your life's blood for my cause. What about that? And so they were offended at the thought of drinking the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ and eating the flesh of the Lord Jesus Christ. They didn't get the typology. And so he says, okay, if that upsets you, if that makes you mad, notice verse 61, and then Jesus in himself, when Jesus knew in himself that his disciples murmured murmured at it, he said unto them, doeth this offend you? What and if ye shall see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before? In other words, what if you see me, and some of them did, the gravity turn loose and me rise up? Is that going to offend you? Is that going to be upsetting to you as well? It is the spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. Now, I want you to see everything hinges in verse 63. It says, the flesh profiteth nothing. You know what's right up here between my two ears, at least a little bit of it? My brain. And you know what it is? It's flesh. It's vile. It's bent towards sin. And salvation, based on nothing more than believing a simple 1, 2, 3, you know, it's just as vile as the rest of it. It really is. So what really happened, you know, you have to be like Lydia. Remember Lydia, the seller of purple? The Bible says, whose heart the Lord opened. If you don't have that, then you don't have salvation. It doesn't have any room there for just thinking about it and thinking you're a good person and agreeing that Jesus was the Son of God. And first of all, you'll find none of that in the Scriptures, but he has to open your heart. And he makes it very clear, it is the spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you they are spirit and they are life. But there are some of you that believe not. Now, I really believe that 64th verse is really where they begin to get upset with it. He says, there's some of you that don't believe. Now, our Lord Jesus, being the very God-man in the flesh, you know, he's not like me. I look out here and I see people I love and that are my brothers and sisters in Christ. But you know what? Jesus looked out and he could see within the heart. And that's why he said, did I not call you 12 and one of you are a devil? He knew who they were. He knew what Judas was the very first day that he met Judas, and he called him anyway. True. And so we see that the Lord was giving them some very difficult things, somewhat to swallow. And he says, "Are you going to keep following me or not? Are you going to give up?" Verse 64, but there are some of you that believe not. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they, more than one, who they were that believed not, and who should betray him. So he knew there was just more than Judas that was involved that weren't believers. Maybe he was the only one of the 12, but there were others that were following, that were just going through the routine, that were there for the ride, that were there for the free food, that was there for the fishes. Those individuals, Jesus knew. He knew exactly who they were. So, are you here for the good time and the bad? Notice what he says. Verse 65. And he said, therefore said I unto you, that no man can come unto me except it were given unto him of my Father. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Now, why did they go back? Well, really, a couple of minutes, again, that teaching concerning the body and the blood of Jesus, that really threw them off. But he also said, I'm going back to where I was before. In other words, he said, I am God. I am the God-man, the Lord Jesus Christ. And many of them left. You know, they had been good up to now. They had been fine. But now was the time, okay, am I going to follow him? Because they knew that once he identified himself as Messiah, he knew that the Jewish Sanhedrin would come down on them. And they said, I just can't do it. Verse 67. And then he said, Jesus unto the 12, Will you also go away? Then Simon Peter answered and said, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. And we believe that thou art. And we believe that thou art sure that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered them, have I not chosen you 12, and one of you is a devil? And he spake of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for he it was that should betray him, being one of the 12. And so we see, if you intend to follow Jesus, you're going to have some things to give up. Family, friends, you're going to have to do some things that are not necessarily appealing to the flesh. You're going to have to do some things where people will question your intelligence. Where people will question, why are you doing that? Do you not know what you're giving up? Can you not see what you put behind you? And you just have to continue on to follow the Lord Jesus. That is what we as the Lord's people are going to do. Well, which way will you follow him? Which direction will you go? We have to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. Gospel of Matthew, chapter 27. I want to read a little bit about the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as I say this, words cannot really grasp the misery that our Lord Jesus endured for the price of your sin and my sin if you're saved. I'm not too much on movies concerning the crucifixion or anything much about the Bible because they always get it wrong. But the bloodiness and the cruelty of the cross, we don't appreciate that. And he did it for us. He did it to pay our sin debt. He endured that misery for you and for me and for all the redeemed and all that would ever be redeemed. That was for us. And we can't quite grasp what it was. But could you follow him in it? See, if we stand for the truth, there will be times when it doesn't go that well. Everybody knows Bertito. I can't call him Bertito anymore because he's bigger than me. Bertito means little bird. But he was beat up pretty good in Mexico for simply holding up a sign against sodomy. And I guess he was maybe 16 then. See, he had a decision to make though, didn't he? You say, well, that, you know, It could easily come to that in our nation. Easily. And so we see that as we begin to think about the crucifixion of our Lord Jesus Christ, how far will you follow him? You say, yes, I want to be a Christian. I want to follow him in all things. How far will you go? How far will you follow him in the things of the Lord? Matthew 27, verse 27. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the common hall and gathered to him the whole band of soldiers, and they stripped him and put on him a scarlet robe, stripped all his clothes off, ripped him from his body. And when they had plaited a crown of thorns, they put it on his head. Now, there's nothing that's lost in the translation. That plaited crown of thorns is just what it says it is. Drove into the sides of the head, and the blood came down. Now, if you're not familiar with a thorn, you can come down to our place, and exactly in the middle where Randy's house is going to be built, there's a big thorn tree. And every time I go mow that little lot and go by it, I always think about this. Some of the thorns are that long on it. If you want to see and know what the misery of a thorn is about, come down to the house. I welcome you to go look at it and think about the dearness of our Lord Jesus Christ and the misery he endured for me and you. Now, are you willing to do that? Are you willing to go that route? You say, oh, Brother Larry, not here in the United States. Well, let me freshen you up a little bit. This nation is a God-hater. You know, I hope that we have a stay of grace with our present administration. But by and large, this nation don't view anything but people like us as trouble. We are extremists in their line. So don't think that this is outside the realm of possibility. Verse 30, and they spit upon him and took the reed and smote him in the head. And after that they had mocked him, they took the robe from him and put his own raiment on him and led him away to crucify him. And as they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. They compelled to bear his cross. Now the reason that he couldn't bear his own cross was he had already been beaten so badly that he was weak. He'd already lost so much blood from the crown of thorns that he wasn't able to bear it on his own. And he was already in a great deal of anguish. He was already, because of my sin and because of your sin, if you're saved, he endured that for you. And no doubt it was the very misery, our very guiltiness that held him to the cross. You know, a lot of people would say, talking about the Lord Jesus and, you know, a little bit of difference in how Hebrew people looked at anatomy than we do. And this is our palm right here. And the Bible says that the nails went through here. And some people say the Hebrew looked at the anatomy and that this included in the palm and it was right here. Now, I don't know whichever it was. But, I mean, to me, this is a palm. But everybody said, well, he was up there and ripped his hands out. Well, I'll say this, first of all, it was my sin holding him to the cross. He didn't need the ligaments to hold him up there. Because my sin held him there securely. And yours did too, if you've been born again. So that really is insignificant. But I do know there had to be a great deal of misery. If it was here, the pain was excruciating. It was a horrible death. It was a very painful thing to be endured by anybody, and yet still he did it for us. Yeah. For those that would be us. Are you willing to follow him? Are you willing to go that route yourself? Now, when you look at a historical records, you have to be careful because you get the man's opinion very frequently. But Fox's Book of Martyrs is very good, and it gives an account of everybody except the Apostle John of the other 10 that remained that died a martyr's death. And supposedly Peter's only request was that he might be crucified upside down instead of right side up, because he did not feel himself worthy to die in the way that the Lord Jesus did. But he followed him, didn't he? He followed him into the end. Now, when you say, I want to follow Jesus, I hope you mean that. I hope you mean it full-heartedly. But just know that there's not going to be a lot of fun along the way. There's not going to be a lot of accolades. There's not going to be a lot of people patting you on the back and telling you how great you are. Following Jesus is difficult. Following Jesus is determination. Following Jesus takes, okay, this is what is going to happen in my life, in my home, if you're the man of the house. And as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. That determination, with it comes a great deal of responsibility. And sometimes what you're doing is putting your head in the noose and doing it. It's not, you know what? But we want to be able to praise God and say, yes, I want to be like Jesus. I want to follow Him to the very best of my ability. So what about you? Do you have a sincere desire to follow Him this morning? I dare say most of us, following Him like the apostles did in the night of Gethsemane, don't you? When push came to shove, they left. And then they ran, they no doubt thought, what are we doing? And they snuck back and they wanted to get a glimpse of the trial and what was going on down there. And they got a little bit closer. And somebody comes up and says, to Peter, you're one of them. I can tell how you're talking. You're one of them. And he begins to cuss and swear and say, no, I'm not one of them. See, it was hard to follow Jesus, wasn't it? Very difficult thing. So, What made Peter go from the one who says, I don't know him? I don't even know what you're talking about. Who made that final request to be flipped upside down? Well, he had finally learned to follow Jesus, hadn't he? What about you? Do you follow him every day? Do you follow him with interest? Do you know what his will is like? When he's leading you through the briar patch, do you wonder if you're doing the right thing? Because he will. It's not smooth sailing. So do you know the Lord Jesus Christ this morning? Are you following in his perfect will?